Hi, welcome to the session on CMA part 2, financial decision making. In today's session, we'll be discussing about decision analysis. In the previous session on decision analysis, we worked on special order pricing and make or buy decisions. In today's session, we'll discuss about sell or further process. What does it mean? In simple terms, we produced a product, okay, and we have a customer ready here to buy it, say, for example, $50. This can be further processed. This can be further processed and can be sold at a higher price than this, say for example $80. So you need to take a decision whether to sell at this point or further process and sell it. Of course, you have an additional benefit of $30 here by not selling here, putting some efforts and selling it at this stage. But what is the cost of this further process? If this further process is, say, for example, $3, it is good. Why? Because the additional cost is $3 and the additional benefit is $30, giving us a net benefit of $27. So you suggest not to sell at this point, but sell after further processing at $80 to get a net benefit of $27. But what happens if the processing cost is $35? So what is the additional benefit you are getting here? $30. To get additional benefit of $30, we are spending $35 of no use. So better to sell at this point. So at any point of time, you should always see that what is the additional benefit we are getting. What is the additional cost? Whether the additional benefit what we get is greater than the additional cost incurred or not. As long as the additional benefit is greater than the additional cost incurred, we can further process. Or if the additional cost incurred is greater than the additional benefit, better you sell at this point itself. So we need to maintain a cost-benefit analysis in which the benefit what we receive should be greater than the cost additionally incurred. This is what you need to apply in case of decision-making, like sell at this point or further process and sell at a higher price. The cost-benefit analysis says that if net benefit is positive, better you further process. This decision is especially required in the case of joint production decisions. What is joint cost decision? Joint cost is a cost which is incurred to produce two or more products in a single operation, like oil, we get crude, petrol, grease, etc. in the joint operation. So in the joint operation, we spend some amount here. This amount is spent without knowing that what quantity of product 1, product 2 and product 3 are going to be received. The cost which is incurred when the products were together is called as joint cost. Then we reach a stage where these products can be identified. This is petrol, this is diesel, this is crude, etc. The point at which the products can be identified from the joint operation is called as split up point. At split up point, the products in the joint operations are identified and separated. Once we separate, you may have a customer ready for buying it. That is called sales price at split up point. Say for example, we spent an amount of 100,000 in a common production process, we call it as joint cost. We identified the products at this point that it is product A. As product A, we hit them off. Such a point is called as split off point. At split off point, we separate the products and check whether they have any sales value here. Yes, we have a sales value. $70,000, $50,000. So product A can be sold at $70,000 and product B can be sold at $50,000. But a question may arise that why should I sell at $70,000 here? Why don't I further process it and sell at a higher price? Then take a decision that what is the selling price if I further process it. Say for example, the final sales price after further processing is 120,000. Yes, you have an additional benefit of $50,000 selling between these two stages. But you will be able to sell at 120,000 only when you incur some additional processing costs. What is the additional processing cost? Say 40,000. Yes, compare the additional benefit with the additional cost. So the additional benefit what we receive should be greater than the additional cost. Yes, it is greater, higher by $10,000. So we now feel that it is better to sell after further processing instead of selling at split off point to get an additional profit of $10,000. We approve the further processing of product A, not to sell at split off point, but to be so further processed and sold to get an additional profit of $10,000. Let us conduct the same analysis on product B as well. Product B at this moment at split off point, we can sell it for $50. We are ready customer. But now we are conducting an analysis that whether we can sell it at a higher price after further processing it. Yes, we gathered the information that this product can be sold at $65,000. It is giving us an additional benefit of $15,000. This will only be sold at $65,000 after spending some additional cost. What is the additional cost incurred? $20,000. Is to be compared with the additional benefit received. Now you can observe here, the additional benefit received is $15,000, whereas the additional cost incurred is $20,000. So the benefit is less than the cost incurred, whereas in the previous this product A, benefit was greater than product the additional cost. Additional benefit was greater than the additional cost. So we said go ahead, but here benefit is less than the additional cost, so better not to further process. The product is to be sold at split off point itself. These are the decisions to be taken when the goods are produced in a joint operation, whether to sell at this point or further process and sell. Now in this session, we discussed about the decision analysis, whether a product is to be further processed or not. And what is the thumb rule? The additional benefit should be greater than the additional cost. Now the topic is about the joint cost allocation. Whether a product is to be further processed or not, we discussed in detail. Now the next topic is how to allocate the joint cost to the joint products. To allocate the joint cost to the joint products, we use two methods. One, physical measure method, and two, market-based method. Market-based approach, we have three methods, sub-methods here. One is sales value at split off point method. Sales value at split off point method. NRV method, net realizable value, and percentage gross profit method. Percentage gross profit method. This is sales value. At split off point method. Physical measure method means, say for example, we have 3000 kgs of A, 5000 kgs of B, entire joint cost will be charged to product A and product B in 3:5. Just physical quantities. It is not much popular. Why? Because we are giving importance for the physical quantities but not their values. This is the reason why it is not applied for external reporting purpose. The most used method is NRV method, net realizable value method. These are all market based approaches, and whereas the approach 2 is a physical measure method, unless otherwise the sales value of product A and product B much similar, you should not use this method. Say for example, a product A can be sold at $10, product B can be sold at $9.8. It doesn't make much difference if you use physical measure method. But if the selling price of product A is $40, selling price per product of B is $9.8, if you use a physical quantities method, it doesn't justify the cost allocation. That's the reason why it is not much popular. Okay, let me give you a recap again. We are discussing about the joint cost allocation. Joint cost is the cost which is incurred combinedly for two or more products in the common operation. Say we received two different types of products, product A, product B. Product A 3000 kgs, product B 5000 kgs. These are the quantities received. Now the question is that how much of this 100,000 should be charged to A and B? Because this is commonly incurred, it's a common production cost. We identified this product A and B at split off point here and separated them. Now, if you are using physical measure approach, simply this $100,000 will be allocated to product A and product B, like joint cost 100,000, and the ratio of physical quantities is 3:5, 3000 kgs, 5000 kgs. So product A will have times 3/5, and product B will have, 3/8. And product B 100,000 times 5/8. This will give you the individual cost allocation from the joint cost. Now we understand that the joint cost allocation is calculated based on the physical quantities method. What is market based method? In market based method, just now we discussed that there are three methods. Okay, one of them is sales value at split off point method. Now let me give you a same example. We have a joint cost of $100,000 combinedly incurred for producing product A and product B. We identified them at a split off point as product A and product B. Product A, we received 3000 kgs. Product B, we received 5000 kgs. Say for example, we have a saleable value at split off point itself. In this case, what we need to do is, what is the selling price here? Say selling price of this product is $50, and the selling price of this product is, say for example, $30. Which approach we are in? Approach, market based approach. And what is the method? Sales value at split off point. Sales value at split off point. At split off point. It is value, not the price, please. price is 50 for A and 30 for B. We are talking about sales value. Sales value of A at split of point equals to 3000 units can be sold at split of point at 50. So it is going to be 150,000. Sales value at split of point for product B is 5000 units can be sold at 30 is 150,000. What a coincidence. So 150 is to 150. 1 is to 1. We need to allocate the joint cost to product A, 100,000 times 1 divided by 2, 1 is to 1. Joint cost of B, 100,000 times 1 divided by 2. This is the way you need to allocate the joint cost to the joint products using sales value at split of point method. Now let me explain about the next method called NRV. NRV is a market-based method. NRV stands for net realizable value. For this, let me explain you again from joint cost onwards. Say for example, we have a joint cost of $100,000 to produce two different products, A and B. A 3000 units, B 5000 units. Now A 3000 units are further processed to sell, let's say for example, $120. B also units are further processed to sell, let's say for example, $80. Okay, and to further process, we spent $20 for product A, $30 for product B. So here NRV is nothing but the final sales price minus the selling expenses, further processing expenses. So NRV of A is 120 minus 20 times 3000 kgs. NRV of B equals to 80 minus 30 times 5000 pieces. Again, I'm telling you, very important point is that just do not calculate NRV of per unit. Do not do that. It should be multiplied with the quantities, which is important. Quantities. So now NRV is nothing but the final sales price minus selling expenses. Let me calculate for A. What is the final sales price here? $120. But I can sell it for $120 only after spending $20 minus 20. Like this, I spent on how many units? 3000 units. So the NRV of product A is 120 minus 20 times 3000, that is 300,000. And NRV of product B equals to, I'll be able to sell at 80 after spending $30. So NRV will be 80 minus 30. This is per unit. Okay, but it should be multiplied with 5000 for the allocation of joint cost. Multiplied by 5000. So 50, 80 minus 30, 50 times 50, 250,000. So the NRV ratio of product A and product B equals to 300,000 times 250,000. So four zeros, 40. 30 is to 25. 5 5s 5 6. So you need to allocate this 100,000 in the ratio of 6 is to 5. Joint cost of A equals to $100,000 joint cost times 6 over 11, 6 plus 5. Joint cost of B equals to 100,000 joint cost times 5 over 11. So this is the way you need to allocate the joint cost using NRV method. One important point is that do not take per unit joint cost. Per unit joint cost must be multiplied with the respective quantities, which is very important. See, you can see 3000 units, 5000 units take share in this joint cost. Therefore, it should be multiplied. Now let me explain you the fourth method of joint cost allocation, which is called percentage gross margin method or gross profit method. In market-based approach, we have three methods: sales value at split up point method, net realizable value method, and percentage gross margin method. Here in the last method, that is percentage gross margin method, we give importance for the profitability of the product. Based on that, we distribute the joint cost to joint products. Say for example here, let me take the same amounts. 100,000 is a joint cost. We have a split up point identified two products, A 3000 units, B 5000 units, can be sold at 120 product A, product B can be sold at 150 after spending say $30 of additional processing costs, $20 per year. So this is a scenario. Now the question is, how much of this 100,000 should be charged to A and B? The method what we are going to use is percentage gross margin method. We need to use some steps here to find out gross profit. So to find out gross profit, first and foremost thing what we need to do is you need to find out the total cost and deduct from the sales. See, now product A we are selling at 120 times 20, that is 240,000. Product B can be sold at 150 and so here let me correct it again. I can sell product A, how many units? 3000 units at 120, that is 360,000. Product B can be sold, 5000 units can be sold at the rate of 150, that is 750,000. So my total sales are 1,110,000, 360,000 plus 750,000. Will give you 1,110,000. Now this is my revenue. Here I have two types of costs. One is a joint cost, one is a separable cost, means further processing cost. Okay, let me deduct costs now. Total cost, total cost include further processing cost. Now I am deducting further processing cost. The further processing cost for product A equals to 3000 units times $20, that is 60,000. Product B, 5000 units times $30, 150,000. See, this is a further processing cost of A and B. In addition to this, I have a joint cost also. Okay, let me deduct joint cost straight away, 100,000. This is further processing cost, FPCOST, further processing cost, and this is joint cost, which we do not know how much we spent on A and B. That's what our topic is, in fact. Now, when you deduct total cost from the total revenues, we'll get gross profit. That is 1,110,000 minus 60,000 minus 150,000 minus joint cost of 100,000. So we get a gross profit of 800,000. This is our GP. After calculating GP, what you need to do is you need to find out the percentage gross profit. Percentage gross profit equals to gross profit divided by total sales times 100. What is the gross profit here? 800,000 divided by what is the total sale? 1,110,000 times 100. So 800,000 divided by 1,110,000 times 100 will give you 72.07%. So our gross profit percentage is 72.07%. Now we understand that in this sales, we have a gross profit of 72%. Once you deduct gross profit, you will get total cost. Once from the total cost, when you deduct further processing cost, you will get joint cost. Let me show you that. Now we are calculating the joint cost. This is the actual solution. What we have done so far is just working note to calculate our percentage gross profit. Now product A and product B, sales we already calculated 360,000. For A, 750,000 for B. We know gross profit, that is 72.07%. We should calculate and deduct from the sales 360,000 times 72.07% is 259,452. 750,000 times 72.07%, 540,000, 525,000. When you deduct the gross profit from sales, you will get total cost. Now total cost 750,000 minus 540, 525 is 209,475. 360,000 minus 259,452 will give us 100,548. This is total cost. Total cost means what? The further processing cost as well as joint cost. Just deduct further processing cost. Further processing cost. We know that. That is 60,000 we calculated here. Minus 60,000. That is 20 times 3,000. And for product B, 30 times 5,000. We calculated already 150,000 for product B. Deduct this amount. So 100,548 minus 60,000 will give you 40,548. Then 209,475 minus 150,000 will give you 59,475. This is a joint cost. How to cross check that this is the correct amount? See, this is what we are charging to A and B using a percentage gross margin method, right? We deducted gross profit from the sales, arrived at a total cost. Total cost has two things. One, further processing cost and joint cost. We know further processing cost of each product deducted from that. The arrived amount is joint cost. That is 59,475 plus 40,458 approximately will get 99,933, which is 100,000. Because of this decimal difference, we got the difference 99,933. You are getting 100,000 back. So the joint cost using percentage gross profit method is 40,548 for product A, 59,475 for B. That $2 or $3 difference is due to this $50-$60 difference is due to the percentage change. Otherwise, it's okay. And now in next session, now we will be discussing now on add or drop a segment. When we say segment, the segment can be a product line, can be a branch, can be a customer segment, can be a product segment, can be a geographical segment. So we should see that whether a particular product or particular branch or a particular customer is profitable or not. If not profitable, whether to discontinue the segment. By discontinuing the segment, whether or you know net income will drop or do not drop. Or say, for example, we have three product lines, A, B, and C. C is a not profit-making product line. It's giving us some loss. So we have a question mark that whether this product is to be discontinued so that the resources can be used for product A and product B. We should see number one is that what is the unavoidable cost? We have sales here, you have variable cost, you have some fixed cost. This fixed costs, what are the sunk costs? What are the avoidable cost? What is the unavoidable cost even after discontinuing this product? Say for example, we are getting a loss of $2,000 from this product. Now we want to discontinue. But because we have sales, variable cost, contribution to cover $8,000 of fixed cost. Even after discontinuing this product, this $8,000 fixed cost is still there because it is unavoidable. Say it is corporate president salary. We are charging to product A, product B, product C. Even product C is discontinued, corporate president will still be there. His salary of this $8,000 should be charged to A and B again. The cost of A and B will go up. Okay, even after deducting this $8,000, we are getting a loss of $2,000. So what happens if the product is discontinued? Sales will be zero, variable cost will be zero, thereby contribution will be zero. Then zero minus $8,000, you will get a loss of $8,000 instead of $2,000. So what basically you need to know is that what is the avoidable and unavoidable fixed cost which even be spent after discontinuing the product. This is about financial issues. Sometimes you may have a non-financial factors, like this product is a non-profit making product giving us a loss. Product A is giving you 10,000 profit, product B is giving you $15,000 of profit, whereas product C is giving us $2,000 of loss. So overall 10,000 plus 5,000 or 15,000, 25,000 plus 2,000, we have minus 2,000, we have $23,000 of profit for entire company. Now we have a question mark. We have to take a decision that whether this product C is to be discontinued. Should we drop this product? So far in the previous example, we were discussing that $8,000 of fixed cost cannot be avoided. So instead of 2,000, there will be 8,000 loss. So product has to be continued. Suppose everything can be avoided. All the fixed costs, all the costs can be avoided. So it can be discontinued. But even after that, even you can avoid all the fixed costs, but sometimes what I say is, By discontinuing this product, is there any impact on the sales of product A and product B? That should also be considered. It's a non-financial factor. What does it mean? By discontinuing the product C, is there an impact on the sales of A and B? Suppose C is a complementary product. C is a complementary product, like DVD player, televisions. So by not having DVD players, your sales of the televisions may also go down. Sometimes the impact of the discontinuance of the product which is giving us loss on the sales of the continued products should also be studied before we take a decision to discontinue the product. Say like this is a customer analysis. So this customer, we have a loss of 32,000. Say for example, if you stop selling to this customer to avoid this loss, we must consider that any allocated corporate office costs. See, at least this 8,000 is, you know, borne by this customer profitability here. So if this customer is going to be discontinued, this 8,000 is to be shared by these two companies, two customers. Here profit will decrease here, 8,000. Like this, we'll have to see that all these costs can be avoided or not. So when you discontinue selling this customer, sales will be zero. Most of the variable cost will also be zero, zero, zero. But what about all this? Need to check. If this unavoidable cost is greater than 32,000, better to continue. If this unavoidable cost is more than 32,000, better to continue. So we need to take a decision based on the product, whether it is giving us more loss or, you know, less. Also, whether the impact is there on the sales of the other products or not. Now, in this session, we'll be now discussing about maximizing the contribution using limiting factor. We know contribution. What is contribution? Contribution is the excess of revenues over variable costs. Contribution equals to S minus C. C is profit subject to fixed cost. Contribution is profit subject to fixed cost. So if you want to enjoy more profit, you should earn more contribution because fixed cost is constant. So to have this contribution, what efforts we should put? We should use the high resources very effectively to improve the contribution. But what happens when we have the resources very limited? A limiting factor means scarcity. We may have in shortage of machine hours, labor hours, power, space, capital. These are all called as limiting factors. Bottleneck operations, scarcity, shortage. So how to maximize the contribution using this? Let us first of all find out what is the issue in our company. Say for example, in our company, we have a limited number of machine hours. So we identified the constraint that we do not have enough machine hours and we cannot increase the number of machine hours. And now, say for example, we are producing two different products, product one, product two. Now, which product is highly profitable that should be produced more? And the remaining resources will be given to the other product. So say for example, if you have 3000 machine hours available, first of all, you identify that which product is highly profitable. For that, you should give 3000 units or 3000 machine hours, some machine hours from here to the extent required for product A. And the remaining hours, you can give it to product B. Now let me show you with an example. Say product one can be sold at $60, product two can be sold at $50. Now the variable cost per unit is 36 for A or 35 for B. So the contribution is 24 for product A and product B for 50. So when you see the contribution and give the importance based on the contribution, you will give first rank to the product one and second rank to the product B. Why? Because if I sell one unit of this product one, let me call this A better, A and B. If I sell one unit of product A, we'll get $24. If I sell one unit of product B, I will get $15 only. So when you give rank according to the contribution, we get first rank for product A and second rank for product B. So we give much more importance to product A to allocate the resources. That is, say for example, machine hours. Say the sales manager of product A says that I want 2000 units because there is a good demand for these units. And product B says 2200. We want 2200 units. Now you can see here that the rank one is product A. Therefore, we give importance for producing 2000 units first. And the remaining hours only will be given to, you know, product B. So product B, though they demand 2200 units, we may be able to give 1300 units or 1500 units. Then sales manager of product B questions that why I'm getting only 1300 units when there is a demand for 2200. Gentlemen, we are in shortage of machine hours. As you know that the product A is highly profitable, rank one product. So we are giving importance for this product. We are producing 2000 units. After that, the remaining hours will be given to you to produce product B. So we are purely believing the contribution and giving importance based on that rank. But when we identify that we are facing shortage in machine hours, we should see that what is the time required to produce one unit of A, one unit of B. Say to produce product A, we require 1 minute. Product B, we require half a minute. Okay. So we are getting $24 for 1 minute. We are getting $15 for half a minute. Clear. So if I give 1 minute here, I can get $30 now. The same 1 minute, if I give it to product B, I will get $30 of contribution. See, simply when you observe only the contribution, product A is getting first rank, product B is getting second rank. Say for example, if I see the contribution in terms of limiting factor, that is time, machine hour time. It is 1 minute here, half a minute here. So if I give 1 minute of mission time, I will get $24 by producing A. If I give same 1 minute, I'll get $30 from product B. Now here for 1 minute, it is $24 and it is $30 because half a minute we are getting $15. For 1 minute, you will get $30. Now you should re-rank these products according to the contribution in terms of the machine hour. Ranking that is based on the contribution in terms of machine hour. This will get second rank and this will get first rank. So you will give importance for producing product B first rather than product A. The remaining resources after producing product B, 2200 units, will be allocated to product A to maximize the profit. Now say for example here, we understand that product B is highly profitable. Therefore, let us allocate the resources first of all to product B. Now 2400 only are available. In that case, what we should do? 2400 should be fully allocated to product B first, then product A the remaining. How? Product B requires 2200 units. Each unit requires half a minute. So 1100 hours should be given to product B. Let me call it as product B better. Product B. We have total 2400, from which 1100 is given to product B. Okay. The remaining 1300 will be given to product A. You remember? to produce, there is a demand for 2000 units for product A. Each unit requires 1 minute. So 1 into 2000, you need 2000 minutes. But we have available for only 1300 minutes. So we'll be able to produce only 1300 units. So earlier we used to produce A first and the remaining hours we used to give to product B. But now it is different because we identified the constraint and given allocated the resources in a proper way to maximize the profit. So this way you need to produce only 1300 units of product B, A. So this way we can increase the contribution and maximize the profit. This is the end of the session on marginal analysis, a decision analysis, in which we discussed about special order pricing, maker buy decisions, sell or further process decisions, in which we discussed a subtopic called joint cost allocation. In the joint cost allocation, we discussed four methods: physical quantity method, sales value at split off point method, NRV method, and percentage gross margin method for the joint cost allocation under sell or further process. We also discussed about adding or dropping a segment or product line to maximize the profit. We discussed just now about maximizing the contribution using the limiting factor. This is the end of the session on decision analysis. Thank you. And we'll have a session in the next class on pricing of the products and services. Have a good time.